Song of Solomon, we're in chapter 7 here tonight, and the plan is to finish our study here. It's been fun, and you guys are coming back for more. That's good. So I haven't scared you all away yet. Tonight would be the night, but now it's over after tonight, so it's all good. So now I can really lay it out on the table. We've been reserved a little bit up until now. Tonight, it just all just comes out, so this is good. And then after tonight, we're done. So there you go. We'll be good. So, it's been a fun book. It's been a challenging book to really kind of go through, but very rewarding nonetheless. Just, of course, looking at our own relationships in marriage, this idea of pure intimacy, and then reflecting on even just kind of the picture that we have of Christ and just the relationship we enjoy and have with Him. We've been looking at this outline here. In our study, breaking this down into various reflections, because it's been, again, predominantly the Shulamite woman, Solomon's love interest, who then becomes his bride, and it's been predominantly a book that's written. Of course, Solomon is the one that's the author of the book, but predominantly we're seeing the voice, we're hearing from the Shulamite woman. And of course, there's all these great transactions that are taking place between Solomon and her. We'll see that as we go on. There's other interjections and other comments that are being given by the daughters of Jerusalem. And even tonight, another one coming from a relative of the Shulamite. And so we see different people adding some things. But in chapter 6, what we saw was this exchange taking place between this couple. That's the focus of the book, Solomon, the Shulamite woman here. She was undergoing some marital adjustments. She was having some issues. Remember, she had that dream, and Solomon was kind of locked out, and then he went away, and there was this concern, and she goes out trying to find him, and it's this dream. But again, revealing just this marital adjustment that's going to come. It's a ways into the marriage now, and they're just kind of still working their way through things, and they're learning how to be even more giving to one another. And so as the bliss of initial courtship, the joys of the honeymoon subside, well, then there's an adjustment to figuring out life together as one. And that's a very common ground in marriage, as we're traveling through together. You know, we're never going to find a perfect person. We're never going to have a perfect marriage, because we're two imperfect people. We're two sinners coming together, unifying together. And so all the more, you just have greater potential for fireworks, right? You know, as these two come together. But it's learning here now how to be more like Christ, how to follow Christ, how to live in Christ together in marriage. That's going to be a blessing to one another. And just learning how, you know, not to be just individualistic in your thinking, but how to ultimately die to self and be a blessing to one another. So marriage really becomes a great platform for learning those things. It's within the confines of marriage that suddenly all those flaws that we've been holding on to, that we sometimes get away with, suddenly are exposed, and we realize, oh man, I've been living life so focused on self. I've been really just, you know, dealing with me, and now suddenly in marriage, as you're living with another person and you're doing life together, suddenly all these things just begin to just pop out. But it's in marriage that we get to have those, you know, rough edges get sanded down as the Lord begins to work in us and on us, and we begin to be refined and we grow and become more like Christ. And so marriage becomes a great platform that I believe the Lord, you know, wants to use even just in kind of refining us and making us more like Him. And so we saw last week that this couple was dealing with some of these issues, and yet in the midst of it all, what did they do? They continued to remind each other of this love that they had for one another. That never really diminished. There were struggles, but what they did is they kept coming back and just reminding each other of this love that they had to one another and sought to renew this love for one another. And in this purposeful response, we began to see the many ways that they did indeed love each other and were attracted to each other. And they went through this, you know, detailed listings as they began just to kind of look at one another. And the Shulamite woman just began to kind of, you know, pump up her husband and share all these great qualities about him and features of him that she began to identify. And they went through all these detailed descriptions of one another, awkward as it may be for us. We're just seeing these two living out this love and sharing that with one another. But I love that, because as they sought to renew this love, what happened? The passion and that attraction was once more just kind of fired up. And as we ended in chapter 6, there was this mention of this dance of the two camps. Some have suggested that was a reference to the two of them coming together, right? You know, in love, doing the horizontal boogie, you know what I'm talking about, right? The dance of the two camps, they're coming together, right? And this is what's happening. This is all laid out for us in the book of Song of Solomon. So as we move into chapter 7, it would seem the Shulamite is performing this dance for Solomon now. He's watching this woman doing this dance. And it's kind of like been suggested that this is the Shulamite now doing this dance as a bit of foreplay. And possibly doing this dance in the nude, all right? That's because what we see in chapter 7 is Solomon just beginning to just to go through her features, you know, and just begin to share all these, again, awkward moments with us, but begin to share all these features about the Shulamite woman and begin to lay it out as though she's there in front of him, sans clothing, and just letting it all hang out in all her glory, and in so doing, just revealing her beauty, all right? And so this description gets very vivid, but it reveals for us this maturing love in their marriage. Their very marriage kind of maturing now. As again, this is way past the honeymoon stage. They're well into their marriage. And the imagery used here becomes much more bolder than it was used when we look back on their wedding night, as Solomon was again revealing and recounting just the beauty of his bride. Well, now we see this imagery getting even more bold from that wedding night. And there's a greater freedom, too, in their sexual relationship, which is a normal part of a healthy, maturing marriage. It should be, to just have that freedom to express these things. Listen, if you've been married for, you know, like 10 years, and you're still uncomfortable, you know, dressing or undressing in front of each other, right? You're like, honey, turn the lights out. Get out of the room. You know, and you're freaking out, right? I mean, there should be this idea as we move in along in marriage that we're just becoming more and more comfortable with one another. And there's, you know, no longer these issues of trust or feeling safe with one another, but you are just able to kind of let it all be out in all your glory and just be like, oh man, we're so comfortable. We've matured in this relationship. And that's kind of what we see happening here. So we're going to see that this couple had no such problems with kind of letting it all hang out now in front of them. Okay, so chapter 7, verse 1, it says, how beautiful are your feet in sandals, O prince's daughter. The curves of your thighs are like jewels, the work of the hands of a skillful workman. Your navel is a rounded goblet. It lacks no blended beverage. Your waist is a heap of wheat set about with lilies. So Solomon here, great descriptions, right? We'll break these down a little bit here for you. But Solomon here, he's just head over heels for his wife, right? He's just so enamored by his bride. But what he does is he begins to not just be head over heels, but he begins to kind of go through from heels to the head now in kind of describing her. He's watching her, which again seems like she's doing this dance. He's just kind of watching her and he's starting to notice her feet, you know, right off the bat. Oh, as she's moving along, oh, your feet in their sandals. It's like, oh, your feet are just, you know, they're beautiful. They're a thing of beauty here. Now, we understand feet are feet, right? There's really nothing to get worked up over feet. But to Solomon, he was smitten with just every part of her. Keep in mind now, this is a ways into the marriage. This is at the time when most couples are saying to each other, what's that smell? Is that your feet? Get something on those things. Go have a bath or something, right? And we're just like, come on. I don't need those feet hanging out like that. Come on, you know, we're just freaking out. But here's Solomon. He's enamored even with her feet, and he's just saying how beautiful your feet are in sandals, just again watching them moving along. But Solomon's just expressing this complete love for her and attraction to her in every way possible. And again, in the fact that the feet are being highlighted, me again, like I say, that's just an indication that she's perhaps moving along. And then it moves into this next kind of description: the curves of her thighs, right, are like jewels. So some people kind of seeing that, just the curves of her thighs, just again, this movement that's going on, perhaps in this dance of the two camps, this foreplay that's kind of happening here as they're being drawn together. And so she's moving about, her thighs are just in this fluid motion of this dance. And all of this, he says, is being credited to the hands of a skillful workman. He says, this is a fine work of art right here before me. This is Solomon's take on his wife here. This is a work of art, the work of the hands of a skillful workman. That's what her beauty was like to him. And isn't it good to know that we have all been made by the hands of a skillful worker? Isn't that great to think about that? That we have a master designer that has formed every part of you, every part of me, and there's nothing we need to complain over or be upset by because we're all unique, we're all different. You were created just as you were by God, a master, skillful workman. And what a blessing that is for us. Don't be your worst critic. Sometimes we can just beat ourselves up. Why am I like this? Why do I have this? You know? So we just need to thank the Lord, God, that you made me. You've given me life. You've made me just the way that you want me to be. And I need to be content in that. I need to look at my life as though this is the design of a master designer right here. All right? This right here is a work of art. All right? I'm not saying me specifically, but if you want to receive that, just receive that. Okay. But all of you can say that this is a work of art. You are a work of art because you were made by a designer, a masterful designer, skillful workman. Now, in verse 2, we have a couple strange comparisons there, don't we? Comparisons to body parts and food and drink. It says her navel was like a rounded goblet. That's probably not something that's going to help your case, men, in getting, you know, using that line with your wife here. Don't try that on them. But for Solomon, his intention was to just share how her whole stomach region was like a tasty, you know, treat for him. It was like a meal with delicious wine, right? And just, he was soaking it up. He cannot wait to take his fill. It would seem that Eastern men just had no problem with, you know, women not being on the thin side here, right? Solomon is more than satisfied with his wife. And so he likens her again to the waist being like wheat. And so just a good, you know, bushel, I don't know what a thing of wheat would be. But he was just, man, this is great. I can really just get myself, you know, around this woman and there's something to hold there. And he was just, again, enamored by her. And so some interesting descriptions that, again, don't translate much to today, so don't try them out on your wives or wives-to-be, but the idea is there, just being so attracted and enamored that you are just ready to take your fill here. And it reminds us, too, when he talks about the navel being like that goblet, you know, and he says it's lacks no blended beverage, speaking of, you know, kind of a spice drink, an intoxicated drink. Remember what Solomon told his son in Proverbs 5, verse 5 to 19. It said, drink water from your own cistern and running water from your own well. Should your fountains be dispersed abroad, streams of water in the streets? Let them be only your own and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. As a loving deer and a graceful doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times and always be enraptured with her love. So what Solomon says later on in his life to his son is drink water from your own cistern. And that's what Solomon's doing. He's like, your navel is like a goblet. It's like a cistern for me. This is where I'm going to take my drink and be satisfied in. I'm not going to go elsewhere. I'm not going to let my fountain even pour out or water from my well pour out into the street. I'm not going to go elsewhere. I'm going to be satisfied right here with you. And this is what Solomon is communicating to his wife. And that idea there at the end of Proverbs 5 in verse 19, always be enraptured with her love. It's that, literally speaking of being intoxicated, be intoxicated with your spouse. Just be so enraptured, enamored, be intoxicated like you are just, you know, in a stupor over her. You're just like, somebody's hit me with some love potion right here. And we're to be so taken by the beauty and love of our spouse. And so then in verse 3, back in chapter 7 here, he says, your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle. That was mentioned earlier in chapter 4, verse 5, and here he's repeating it. But again, later in marriage, what do we see? He's saying the same thing. He's still enamored with her. He's still seeing and being captivated by this beauty and by her assets. Her breasts were still like two soft, innocent young deer and matching in form and beauty. He's like, they're still just that work of art for me. It's still doing it for me, is what Solomon is saying. He said it to her back in early marriage, but now he's not like, hey, honey, you know, you should be working out a little bit and getting a little bit, you know, saggy there or something. He's like, no, this is still, I am still enraptured by you, right? And he's just elevating her in her beauty and making her just feel so comfortable and free with him. Verse 4, your neck is like an ivory tower. Your eyes like the pools in Heshbon by the gate of Bath Rabbim. Your nose is like the Tower of Lebanon, which looks towards Damascus. Again, here's Solomon using some interesting terms and analogies here. But again, he's working his way up now, and he's moving to her neck. And it's just like this ivory tower. It's not speaking of this neck being like disproportionately long, you know, like olive oil, right? And Popeye, remember that character, just this, you know, string bean, just long neck. It's not that it's proportionally long or anything. It spoke, however, this tower idea spoke of nobility and strength. And so she carried herself with this elegance and confidence. He's probably complimenting not only the noble dignity exemplified in her posture, but also this artistic smoothness of her neck as he gently perhaps slid his fingers down her neck. It was smooth as ivory to him. And he says she had eyes like the pools in Heshbon. And these pools, no doubt, were peaceful and beautiful. There was a tranquility to them as he feels, just as he looks into her eyes, there's just this calm and peace that he's just, you know, just comes over him as he just gazes into her eyes. Your nose is like the Tower of Lebanon. A tower that's looking out towards Damascus, you know, would be a tower that indicated defensive strength, because Damascus, the capital of Syria, Syria was always that kind of perennial enemy to Israel and caused trouble for Israel. So here's this tower looking out to Damascus. So again, spoke of this defensive kind of strength. And so too, this woman had this characteristic of strength. She was ready to defend against trouble. Perhaps her nose was literally large. A large nose perhaps was a feature that was well admired in this day. We don't know. I think it's still to be admired today too. Large noses are a good thing. But it could just also be a picture of her inner characteristic of strength too. Verse 5, your head crowns you like Mount Carmel, and the hair of your head is like purple. The king is held captive by your tresses. So Mount Carmel was known for its beauty, that majesty with just the splendor of Mount Carmel. So the Shulamite conducted herself in that same way. So her head was viewed like that in just splendor. Her hair being purple doesn't indicate she's experimenting with some kind of, you know, punk hair design here. It speaks of a regalness, a royalty to it. She certainly embodied this royal look, one that kept even the king captive with her. And so he's held captive by her tresses, her flowing hair, her locks of her head. Now, on their wedding night, he gave her a sevenfold praise. We went through that back in chapter 4. But now, at a later time in their marriage, what happens? This is no longer now a sevenfold description of her. This is a tenfold description as he lays out all these features, as he count them up, you know, going from her feet to her thighs, to her navel, and all. There's 10 features that he brings up. So again, there's this growth that we see happening as he's expanding on these things now that he is describing and showing just his love and just desire for her. Their love had truly deepened. And I trust that as you grow in your days together with your spouse, as your marriage progresses into maturity, that your love for one another grows and deepens, that it continually finds new ways to kind of be expressed and shared with one another. We don't have to be the couple that's nagging at each other and just trying to coexist together. Sometimes that's kind of the stereotypical, oh, we've been married for 40 years and he still doesn't listen to me, blah, blah. And there's a stereotypical view, like, you know, the longer you get in your marriage, the more, you know, you have a right just to kind of be nagging on each other and just kind of putting each other down. Well, we've earned that, you know. But I think as we progress in our marriages, we should become even more loving to each other and just become even more enamored with each other and expressing that kind of love to each other. It should be blossoming and growing towards greater intimacy and joy. And I think Solomon and the Shulamite woman, his bride here, is exemplifying that here for us. And then in verse 6, we read, how fair and how pleasant you are, Oh, love, with your delights, the stature of yours is like a palm tree, and your breasts like its clusters. I said, I will go up to the palm tree. I will take hold of its branches. Let now your breasts be like clusters of the vine, the fragrance of your breath like apples, and the roof of your mouth like the best wine. So Solomon, here in verse 6 and 7, he continues to affirm his love and his desire for her. He compares her to a palm tree, which is tall and stately in stature. He's not just drawn to her outer beauty, but there was something that registered with him from an inner kind of beauty. This character and dignity was solid. She conducted herself with these traits and this character that was just really attractive to Solomon. This kind of dignity and just solid character. And so he saw in her a palm tree with clusters of fruit. She was somebody that greatly satisfied him. And so this dance, this foreplay has been performed, and now they're ready to get on with the act. And in this, we see that the couple, within their marital adjustments now, that's what we've been looking at in our outline here, this reflections on marital adjustments. The first part of that in chapter 5 and 6 was dealing with kind of difficulty. But now what we're looking at in these marital adjustments is that they're willing to kind of grow and to kind of branch out in this relationship and to it kind of experiment and try new things here. They weren't just going with the status quo or being predictable in their relationship. They were being creative in their relationship together. And through this, we see here that the fire of passion and intimacy was just continuing to burn bright. Listen, that's a good word for us in our marriages, to not get boring in your relationship. Don't settle for routine. Don't just kind of get into a rut, basically. Keep things fresh within your marriages. Do those things that keep the fire burning bright towards love and intimacy. Don't be afraid to kind of spice things up as long as both parties are in agreement. Don't be afraid to kind of branch out and try new things together, you know. And here this couple is, again, they're showing that. They're doing things that are kind of new for them, and there's just this freedom that they're enjoying with one another. And so Solomon, as we read there in verse 8, he says, I will go up to the palm tree. I will take hold of its branches. Let now your breasts be like clusters of the vine, the fragrance of your breath like apples, and the roof of your mouth like the best wine. So he's pictured as climbing the palm tree, and that's a sexual image that has its basis even in the pollination of palm trees. Because to fertilize a female palm tree, the gardener would climb the male tree and take some of its flowers, and then he would climb the female tree and tie that pollen-bearing flower among its branches. That's how they'd kind of fertilize these or pollinate these palm trees. And so here, what the picture is now is not Solomon finding a palm tree. He's like, I'm going to get together with you, Shulamite, my wife, and they are coming together in this intimacy now. They're engaged in lovemaking. They're close. They're intimate. He can smell her breath, right? I mean, he's like, your breath, that's how close they are. I can smell your breath. And thankfully, it's smelling like the fragrance of apples. That's a good thing. Unlike Job, who said in Job 19:7, my breath is offensive to my wife. Some of you girls maybe are like, oh man, yeah, I don't want my husband getting that close to me because that's not a good thing, right? So, but here this couple, they're just engaged now in lovemaking. And again, he says, the roof of your mouth like the best wine. So they're just macking hard together. They're just making out. They're just, you know, going for it. He can taste the roof of her mouth. And he's like, it's like fine wine. It's a beautiful thing, right, that they're experiencing here. And now the Shulamite, which is she enters into the conversation now and responds with this equal kind of pleasure and satisfaction, because in the second part of verse 9, it says, the wine goes down smoothly for my beloved, moving gently the lips of sleepers. So she has engaged now in this night of passion, and she recognizes its goodness. And it's a good thing to give your body to your spouse in a physical way like this. It says in, Paul wrote in, is it 1 Corinthians 7 or 2 Corinthians 7? But do not deny yourself each other except, you know, for a time. When you go away and you're maybe spending time with the Lord, but don't deny yourselves of each other in marriage. And so here's these two now. They're just coming together in a very physical way. It's a good thing to do that. This in itself is a great promoter of intimacy. You know, when you talk to couples who have been struggling in their relationship, this is one area that has long been forsaken. When's the last time you guys been intimate? Oh, it's been years. And you wonder, well, there's no doubt that you guys have been struggling just in getting along and just kind of working through this marriage. It's very hard to be angry and mad at each other when you're both naked and enjoying this physical act of being one together. It's hard to be angry. But listen, you've got to continue to work at keeping this a desire in your relationship. I understand sex doesn't fix everything. But when sex is forsaken, it becomes that much more difficult to keep yourself functioning in unity and harmony in the relationship. And there are times where we need to very unselfishly just give ourselves for one another and continue to be one as God intended marriage to be, is to be all about oneness together. And this act certainly is a great way to see that take place. Now, Glickman said this, whereas the wedding night focused on the purpose of sex as the consummation of marriage, this night now, later into the marriage, focuses on the purpose of sex as the nourishment of marriage. As they fell asleep, the last kiss lingered in each other's minds like the aftertaste of good wine. What an enchanting picture of the sleeping couple, just satisfied. I'm sure just drifting off to sleep with a smile on their face here. But this is the great picture here. This was for nourishment. This wasn't just for consummation now as it was on the wedding night. This is for nourishment. This is to bring health into the relationship. And it should be noticed that though the song is really the bride's song here, there are three occasions when the groom describes her beauty in detail. And there's only one time that we see the bride describing the groom's beauty in detail. It's a 3-to-1 ratio here, where the groom is more so expressing his desire and love and the beauty of his bride. If the song has any allegorical significance, it should indicate that God finds us much more delightful than we find him. Listen to what Harry A. Ironside said. He said, "It is a wonderful thing to know that the Lord has far more delight in his people than we ourselves have ever had in him. Someday, we shall enjoy him to the fullest. Someday he'll be everything to us. But as long as we are here, we never appreciate him as much as he appreciates us. But as she listens to his expression of love, her heart is assured. She has the sense of restoration and fellowship." I pray that we always have that sense of just fellowship with the Lord, understanding how great of a love our Father has for us. Now in verse 10 here, chapter 7, it says, "I am my beloved's and his desires toward me." Here she is expressing this understanding and this comfort, knowing how much her husband loves her and desires her. She was secure with her husband's love for her. She even knew that his desire was for her. It's neat to see this love and maturing of this relationship and marriage taking place, because earlier in chapter 2 and in verse 16, she said, "My beloved is mine, and I am his." My beloved is mine. Then in chapter 6, verse 3, she said, "I am my beloved's and my beloved is mine." There was always that emphasis on what was hers, right? But now there's no longer any emphasis on her. There's no kind of manipulation or trying to claim him. She simply concludes now, "I am his. I am my beloved's. I'm his." You know, some Christians try manipulating God and think that he exists for them, that they can make their demands, and God is like that genie in the bottle. He just needs to respond to me now. I've made my demand. I've made my claim. I've put it out in a prayer, and so now God has to respond to me. But the reality is that he is God, and we're just his servants. And God doesn't exist for us. We exist for God. We should say, "I am my beloved's." Simple as that. I am his. But the beauty is, we understand, as the Shulamite woman said, God's desire is for me. When I give up control, I don't need to fear that he's going to make things miserable for me now, because his desire is to bless us. And there's great joy when we surrender to the Lord and simply say, "I'm yours, Lord. I'm all in. I'm yours. Because it's there that you really see then his desire for you come through, and it is for your good as he has your best interest at heart. And we get to see just the blessing of the Lord be poured out all the more as we surrender and say, I'm yours, Lord. We are our beloved's. And so in verse 11, she continues on to say, come, my beloved, let us go forth to the field. Let us lodge in the villages. Let us go up early to the vineyards. Let us see if the vine has budded, whether the grape blossoms are open and the pomegranates are in bloom. There I will give you my love. The mandrakes give off a fragrance, and at our gates are pleasant fruits. All manner, new and old, which I have laid up for you, my beloved. So here we see the Shulamite woman just continuing to kind of think up creative ways to just enhance their relationship. She invites Solomon out for a weekend getaway. I have no idea if it was a weekend getaway, but she's like, let's go head out now to the countryside. Let's have some time alone here. It would be the equivalent of us having a weekend getaway with our spouse, which is very good to do in your marriages. Just kind of say, you know what? We need to just sort of get away and leave kind of all the distractions here of life and just have some time where we can just focus on one another, focus on our relationship. That's a good thing to do. And so the Shulamite invites Solomon for a trip to the countryside. She says, let us see if the vine has budded. And so what we see here is that this is moving into springtime now. And springtime was a very special time, even in their relationships. Back in chapter 2, verse 10 to 13, we saw that their whole courtship was taking place during this springtime. It was kind of a picture of love sort of blossoming, right? Even within their own courtship. Now we've seen this relationship go from spring to spring and several years in between. But again, they've matured through these various cycles of growth now, is what we see happening here. And so we see the evidence of that in how this woman is speaking to her man. She says very plainly, what does she say? There I will give you my love. There in verse 12. Let's go out to the countryside. Let's get away. Let's have some time one with another. And there I'll give you my love. Now, she's speaking his language here. This is where Solomon's ears are perking up, huh? What? All right. It's good. Ladies, listen, you can be those that initiate sex. That's not wrong. It's not unbiblical. It's right here. She's doing it here, and we're being reminded of that. You're not going to ruin your reputation by doing so, all right? Men, can I get an amen from any of you bold people out there? No? Okay. All right. It's all good. It's all good. Listen, ladies, here's the deal. Dude, don't be afraid to speak your husband's language. Don't use sex as a bargaining tool, but sex can certainly be a great incentive. It's amazing what your husband will be willing to do with a little incentive of some physical intimacy. For example, you say, hey, honey, I'm going to the craft fair with my mother. Want to come? And he's like, what? I mean, I'd rather have needles poking my eyes than do something like that. And she says, well, I thought afterwards we could drop the kids off with mom and then enjoy a little alone time. And you know what I mean by a little bit of alone time. And he's like, where's my coat? All right, let's go, right? And suddenly, what he did not want to do is like, I'm in. I am all in. There's a little incentive going on. You're not using this as manipulation, but you're just saying, hey, you know what? I know it's going to be a blessing to you here. And so here's the Shulamite woman just saying, listen, let's go for a little walk. Let's head out to the countryside. Let's go for a cruise. And you're going to want to come because there, I'm going to give you my love. And he's like, all right, let's go. He's like already in the car driving away without her. He's like, what's going on? Okay, he's just ready to go. So she's prepared the way now for this love to be real joy, to be pleasurable. And she mentions the mandrakes there. The mandrakes was a plant that was understood to be like an aphrodisiac. So she's kind of lining everything up. She's like, I'm preparing the way. I'm laying down the groundwork. She's wanting to explore new and old ways for this lovemaking to be enjoyed. And she's preparing the way to do that. She's willing to be creative here as the marriage is progressing. She's not just wanting to stay in a rut, you know, not just satisfied with status quo. She's like, we're gonna do some creative things here. We're gonna keep things fresh. Now, what the Song of Solomon promotes for us is really the enjoyment of sex. And I'm I'm glad that God's given us a book like Song of Solomon here, because sexual intimacy is not just for procreation. It's for pleasure as well. Notice there's no mention of any children in this book. We're not talking about them raising a family. We're talking about them enjoying this physical act for pleasure together and for the promoting of oneness and unifying together, strengthening the marriage. This is not talking about just being fruitful and multiplying. As much as that is God-given and in intent, it's like it's not only that. And I'm thankful that God's given us a book where we get to see how this can be demonstrated, played out, and even God's heart for this, to bless us, for this to be a pleasurable, satisfying thing for us. That God's not a prude, not going, oh, man, you guys just whatever you do, just keep it to yourselves. I don't know anything about that stuff, you know? And as Christians, we can be that way sometimes. Now, I think sometimes we've gone, some churches today go the opposite. It's like, let's see how racy we can get with this stuff and let's be as crazy as the world is with this stuff. I'm not saying that, but I think there's a real blessing in just kind of being open and that God desires this to be an open thing and something that is intended to be for our good, for our blessing, and for our pleasure. It's intended to be between a husband and a wife, again, to promote that kind of togetherness and just growth together. And so I'm thankful for that. Chapter 8 says, oh, that you were like my brother who nursed at my mother's breast. If I should find you outside, I would kiss you. I would not be despised. I would lead you and bring you into the house of my mother. She who used to instruct me, I would cause you to drink of spiced wine, of the juice of my pomegranate. Now, this isn't a weird thing that she's requesting, saying, oh, that you were like my brother. This isn't the Shulamite, like, you're getting a little bit weird on us now here. What's going on? The idea here is that she would be able to freely show her affection to a brother, a family member in public in that day, for two lovers to kind of be showing public displays of affection was not a appreciated thing as it is today. When you see somebody, you know, making, I just kind of like, guys, would you just not do that in front of me here, you know? I like to do that with my wife sometimes just because it bothers her too, as well as others that are watching. But enough about me. But it's, you know, the whole PDA thing, that's just too much PDA. Come on, get a grip, people. And it was the same way in that day. It just wasn't done. So she's saying, if you're like my brother, then we could just, you know, hold each other. We could show this affection without anybody kind of looking down on us for this. So just again expressing this desire to be with him. She's becoming so free with her expressions of love. And Solomon, you see, you got to commend Solomon because he's created this atmosphere of trust and security that she's completely opened up in these ways in the relationship. You know, he's been so loving and doting on her and just building her up that now she just feels so free and secure in this relationship. Men, it is so important that we keep working towards building an atmosphere where our wives are comfortable, where they feel secure, where there's that trust, you know, secure to be who they are and secure in your love for them. And when you do, you'll see a beautiful flower just bloom that produces a real strengthened and mature love in your relationship. And that's what we see unfolding here with the Shulamite and Solomon here. And it says in verse 3, his left hand is under my head and his right hand embraces me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases. So again, here they are. It seems like they're in that, you know, posture now of just lovemaking. And she gives this warning again, the third time now, this warning. Do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases. Now, in chapter 2, verse 7, it was in the context of marriage where sexual passion should not be aroused unless it can be satisfied. Otherwise, what happens is it leads to frustration. So again, those that aren't married, don't put yourself in those positions where those passions begin to get, you know, kind of sparked and peaked and aroused to where suddenly you can't fulfill that. It's going to lead to just frustration. Don't even put yourself in that position. Then in chapter 3, verse 5, it was stated in the context of courtship, where sexual passion should not be aroused for it may lead to fornication. And here in chapter 8, verse 4, it's in the context of a proper place, that sexual passion should not be aroused in a place where it cannot be satisfied. And so she's given this warning to her maidens, the daughters of of Jerusalem there. And then in verse 5, you read, who is this coming out from the wilderness? Leaning upon her beloved. I awakened you under the apple tree that your mother brought you forth. There your mother brought you forth. There she who bore you brought you forth. So as Solomon and the Shulamite approach her home now, there's a relative that calls out to her and reflects on the very place that she was born. He begins to be reminded that this is, you know, her home now. This is where she's from, where she, the very place where she was born, and being reminded of that. And then in verse 6, she says, set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm. She's speaking to her beloved, to Solomon. For love is as strong as death. Jealousy is cruel as the grave. Its flames are flames of fire, a most vehement flame. Many waters cannot quench love, nor can the floods drown it. If a man would give for love all the wealth of his house, it would be utterly despised. And so now, you're the Shulamite, speaking to Solomon, says that she wants to be that seal on her husband's heart and arm. And that seal was a sign of ownership. It spoke of authority here, saying, I want to be just fully yours. I want you just to kind of be over me in this. And to be over the heart pictured that affection and love. The arm here was a symbol of strength. And so what she's saying is that I'm fully yours. I want to be just under you. And she's completely trusted him with her life. And she knows he will love her, pictured by the heart, that he will protect her, picturing that arm of strength here. He's going to love her. He's going to protect her. And love, it says, is as strong as death. You see, love is very sacrificial. In fact, we can't fully walk in love unless we're willing to surrender ourselves, to lay ourselves down. I don't believe the opposite of love is hate, as so many would say it is. I believe the opposite of love is self. Because when we begin to get focused on self, we can no longer be loving. Loving is unconditional, it's sacrificial. And if we're focused on self, we can't love in the proper way. We need to see ourselves removed of self if we're going to love properly. For love is as strong as death. It is like death because we need to learn to die to self in that process. And just as we need to die to self to love, jealousy can be a raging focus of self. There's many marriages have been destroyed because of jealousy. Sometimes very needlessly, where we make more something than it is. We need to be sure that we're promoting trust in our marriages that don't allow a root of jealousy or bitterness to kind of creep in. And that oftentimes comes again because of just that focus on self. Now, if a man would give for love all the wealth of his house, it says, and that seems to be a take on that once popular song, Can't Buy Me Love, right? This is the idea here. You can't put a price on love. If a man would give for love all the wealth of his house, then again, it says that would be despised. It would be utterly despised. Love is not a piece of merchandise that can be bought, that can be purchased with the right amount of money. It cheapens it when that's attempted. It cheapens what love is to be. Love must be given. Love must be received freely. Love is despised when it's deduced to a monetary value. And then in verse 8, here's the Shulamite's brother speaking up, saying, and again, it would seem this is a reflection back now in time when the Shulamite woman was growing up in the home here before she had gone with Solomon. And they're reflecting on this because they say, we have a little sister. She has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister in the day when she's spoken for? When there's a husband found for her. If she is a wall, then we will build upon her a battlement of silver. And if she is a door, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. Some very unusual kinds of terminology and description given here. But again, what's taking place is the brother saying, listen, if she's a wall, meaning if she's pure, if she's kind of protected herself, she's put up a wall and she's not allowed herself to, you know, be taken advantage of, if she's not lost her virginity, basically, then she's going to be pure. They're going to build her up. They're going to, you know, build upon her battlement of silver. It's going to be a precious jewel here. And she's going to be given over in a marriage. But if she's a door, she's kind of allowed herself to be open, she's impure, then it says, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. We're going to shut her in all the more then. And again, she's not going to be given over in marriage. And so she responds here. What does she say? I am a wall. I'm a wall. It's all good. I've been pure. I've kept myself for my husband. And she says, then I became in his eyes as one who found peace. She found peace in her beloved's eyes. Verse 11 to 12 says, Solomon had a vineyard at Baal Hamon. He leased the vineyard to keepers. Everyone was to bring for its fruit 1,000 silver coins. My own vineyard is before me. You, O Solomon, may have 1,000, and those who tend its fruit, 200. So the idea here, evidently Solomon leased part of his vineyard to the Shulamite brothers who put her to work in it, as we saw back in chapter 1, verse 6. And there she met Solomon. Her own vineyard probably refers to her own person. The Shulamite promised to give all of herself to Solomon freely, whereas he needed to pay wages to those who worked in his literal vineyard. Then in verse 13, you who dwell in the gardens, the companions, listen for your voice. Let me hear it. Make haste, my beloved, and be like a gazelle or a young stag on the mountains of spices. So here the story ends now with the wife of Solomon calling out to him to come and be with her in a pure intimacy once more. Make haste, my beloved. Come to me is what she's calling out to again, where they will enjoy this great opportunity to be husband and wife together and to continue to unite together as one. So listen, let's in close just look at a few applications here now as we look at kind of the bigger picture and that application of the believer's life and his relationship with Christ. And just as we saw there in the first verse of chapter 7, where Solomon's going over the various descriptions of his wife and began with the feet of the bride and his description of her, we need to realize as well the importance of our feet because it speaks of our walk with Jesus. We're told in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 15, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In other words, we need to be prepared with the gospel of Jesus Christ in our walk. We need to be living in a way where we're able to reflect this great good news that we have in Jesus, that he came and died for us. He came to be the very bridegroom for us. He gave his life so that we could have and enjoy this great relationship with him. We need to be walking in a manner where we're shedding light on this great relationship we have with Jesus, this very gospel, this good news. And we need to be prepared with that. It says in Isaiah 52, verse 7, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. And we need to be carrying that message to people that we have a great God, we have a Savior, and not only has he died on the cross to save us of our sin, but he's brought us in now to enjoy the greatest relationship of all. So may we have this beautiful feet that are carrying the gospel out to this world. We saw in chapter 8, verse 5, the bride and groom returning to the bride's home with her leaning on her beloved there. Very interesting. Charles Spurgeon used this as a picture of the closeness and the dependence of the church upon Jesus Christ. Many things could be said as true regarding both the maiden and the people of God, that she leaned because she was weak and needed strength. That's true of us for sure. She leaned because the way was long. She leaned because the way was perilous. She leaned because the path was ascending, going higher and higher. She leaned because her progress took her more and more away from others and more to her beloved's side. She leaned because she was sure her beloved was strong enough to bear her weight. And she leaned because she loved him. Oh, I trust and pray that we are realizing the importance of leaning on our Savior, leaning on our bridegroom, leaning on him and trusting him every step of the way and drawing ever so close to him in a greater love for him. Charles Spurgeon went on to say, beloved, there's no part of the pilgrimage of a saint in which he can afford to walk in any other way but in the way of leaning. He cometh up at the first and he cometh up at the last still leaning upon Christ Jesus and leaning more and more heavily upon Christ the older he grows. And then we saw again about this idea of this jealousy coming in verse 6. Jealousy is cruel as the grave. Its flames are flames of fire. But I love how God is described as a jealous God. Sometimes people hear that, they think about that. God's jealous. How does that work? How can that be? That just seems like God just kind of flies off the handle and he goes into a rage. But understand, when we speak about God's jealousy, he's jealous for you. His love for you is such that he wants to protect you. And he's jealous for you, meaning that he doesn't want to see you drift off into other things that are going to take you away from him and take you away from the blessing that he has for you. He's jealous not in a rage and in kind of a going off in a corner, pouting and getting upset that you're not spending time. He's desiring to protect you. That's the jealousy of God. That doesn't hurt us, but protects us. That desires to keep us close to him. Now, this whole book here is just a great overview of the relationship that we enjoy and will enjoy with Jesus. Because as we've seen all the way through now, just as Solomon came in disguise, remember that first time when he visited that vineyard, Jesus came the first time in disguise to his own vineyard, to the nation of Israel. And while the leaders of the nation rejected him, one small part of the nation fell in love with him. That small, seemingly unloving or unlovely part was the common man. It was then the disciples that gathered before him. And then it was the Gentiles that were gathered in. The people that were seemingly the outcast, the unlovely. But yet Jesus drew them in. But then he went away, really, to prepare the place for his marriage to the Shulamite. In the same way, just as Solomon went away back to his palace and the Shulamite woman followed, in the same way Jesus went away to prepare a place for us. And when he comes again, he comes in glory, just as Solomon did. He will call us by name and we shall go to meet him and sit at the banqueting table with Jesus. And there we will hear the precious words of our Savior and King as he tells us of his great love for us and how lovely we are to him. And we'll finally be able to look him in the eyes and be able to tell him ourselves personally, just think about that, how much we love him, how great his love has been for us and how great our love is for him. That's what we see unfolding in its entirety through this book. And it's a great picture and illustration even for us of just what Jesus has done for us, what he has secured for us, and of the fellowship, the relationship that we, the bride of Christ, get to enjoy with our bridegroom, Jesus. We are so blessed. So tonight, I just thought we'd just close with a couple songs of just worship and just expressing that love to the Lord. Let me pray, and then we'll just enjoy a bit of worship before we're heading out back into the cold, all right? Heavenly Father, we thank you for getting us through the book of Song of Solomon without anybody throwing things at me or getting up and leaving and being able to brave through this difficult book, this very transparent book. But Lord, I pray that these have been things that we've not kind of just sort of looked at awkwardly or made it a joke of, but really taken to heart and realized, God, that you are for marriages coming together in pure intimacy and growing together and enjoying one another. You've given us this wonderful gift of love and sex that can be enjoyed in marriage, that we don't have to kind of hide out from or be awkward over. Lord, you've given us this great gift and act to be enjoyed and to enhance marriage, causing couples to grow even more closer together as one. So I pray that we'd follow these things that we've learned through this book. And Lord, that you would bless the marriages represented here and the marriages within the church at large, that, Lord, we'd see marriages continuing to grow in maturity and just being fresh, not getting into ruts, not becoming complacent, but Lord, ever growing in their love and in the expression of that love one to another, as we've seen so much here with Solomon and the Shulamite. So bless marriages, may we honor you through them and be a reflection even of just this great relationship we enjoy with you, Jesus. And so we pray these things in your name, amen. Let's all stand together and let's just take some time and express our own love just to our Lord and Savior for all he's done for us.